We now move into a new set of perspectives on the phenomenon we've been looking at all day. The session is called Paradigms on Human Security, related to the consequences of the phenomenon we've been looking at scientifically. Two great colleagues will be on this panel. My friend Jay Familietti, who is a professor of Earth System Science and Civil and Environmental Engineering. He'll be followed by my friend and colleague Richard Matthew, who's the director of the Center for Unconventional Security Studies. He and I have done many programs together, excellent communicator. I want to catch us back on time. Jay?
What I want to do is actually follow on from the presentation that Isabella gave on the GRACE mission, where she focused on what's happening with the ice sheets. And I want to talk about the implications or the use of the GRACE mission to track water storage changes on the land. And so the tie to this workshop is that a lot of that water, as you just heard from Dan, is coming from snowmelt, it's coming from glacier melt, okay, and is recharging our aquifer. So I'll talk a lot about groundwater around the Tibetan Plateau and in the Himalayas. And then Professor Matthew will talk about some of the security implications for what's happening, and they are profound. Okay, so I will start to, and of course Richard and I are completely uncoordinated in terms of our presentation. So I'll give a bunch of slides, and I left this last line here, so I'll talk about what the GRACE mission is. Isabella talked about that, so I can kind of skip over that. I'll get to some of the high points about freshwater storage changes, focusing on the Himalayas and the Tibetan Plateau. I'll also launch into a little global work to kind of follow on what some of our speakers talked about this morning. And then I left this big space here down the bottom of the page there for Richard, because I thought, you know, magically we would come together and make a great presentation. Of course, that didn't happen. Okay, so I can just quickly go through the GRACE stuff, because Isabella covered it so well this morning. Remember when she was talking about weighting the earth? Do you remember that part this morning? Weighing the earth this morning? Well, so this is what GRACE does. It's a gravity mission. And it was launched in 2002. And so you can see these two satellites here that look like little school buses. They're up about 450 kilometers in the atmosphere, and they're about 220 kilometers apart. And so the key measurement that's made is one that's a very precise measurement of the distance between that satellite. I mean, it's the accuracy with which the distance between the two is measured is at the sub-micron level. A micron is a thousandth of a millimeter. The distance between those two is perturbed by changes in Earth's gravity field. And on land, a lot of those changes come from changes in water storage, because water is very heavy. So you have changes in water storage on land perturbing the distance between these two little, school bus-sized satellites. And those inter-satellite distances being inverted into maps of Earth's gravity field. It was originally planned to last for 5 years, and it's been going for about a decade now, and there's a follow-on plan for 2016. So in a very, very simplified sense, what GRACE has done is helped improve the mapping of Earth's gravity field based on decades of pre-GRACE data. And so it's kind of fuzzy, but you can see sort of some of the tectonic and topographic features of the Earth. And then after just about 111 days, of GRACE data in the middle panel, you see that those features are starting to sharpen up, and then after about a year, they get even sharper. And so, in a very simple way, imagine that GRACE is making one of these maps once a month, okay? And that we're looking at the difference in those maps. By looking at the difference in those maps, we can see, you know, the biggest thing that's changing on monthly timescales, if we look at monthly differences, the biggest thing that's changing is the distribution of water on land, in the ocean, in the ice sheets. So the difference between the two global gravity fields gives us this time variable component, and like I just said, the main contributors are changes in water storage in the ocean and in the atmosphere and on land, and mainly because, you know, we all know that water is incredibly heavy. so heavy that if you put a case of water on your couch, and it would sink into the couch cushion, and then when you pick it up. Anyway, another reference to this morning. Anyway, the grace signal on land is really dominated by water storage changes. And one thing that's important to recognize, so we can use the grace mission to basically weigh mass changes on land, and those changes in weight are primarily due to changes in water. Could be snow, could be ice, could be groundwater, could be river water. The space-time limits with which we can apply it, 200,000 square kilometers and greater on a monthly basis with an accuracy of about 1.5 centimeters. And this is just a picture here from the Yangtze River that shows you what some of the storage time series look like. They go up and down. They have a seasonal cycle as we get rain and then evaporation in the dry season and rain in the wet season. And in this case, there's an overall upward trend. All right, so let me just, in the interest of getting us back on time, talk about freshwater storage changes and talk a little bit about the Himalayas and the Tibetan Plateau. This is a map very much like a map that Isabella showed this morning. It's a map of trends in water storage on land from GRACE. And we used the time period about 2002 to 2009. And our color scale, I think, is probably different than what Isabella had. And a lot of hydrologists, and I noticed that, thankfully, Dan had this in his slides. Red usually means drier, and blue usually means wetter. And so we've labeled a lot of these spots here on this map where people have done studies or were doing studies, or we think we have a pretty good idea of what's going on. And so, you know, there's a few things that are pretty striking about this map. Overall, so if we just kind of see through the blobs and look at colors, we see it's sort of bluer up here and bluer. So bluer at high latitudes and bluer in the tropical regions. And that suggests to me that perhaps we're already seeing this redistribution, because blue means getting wetter in this time period. So perhaps we're already seeing this redistribution of moisture that the IPCC models suggest. And of course, it's redder in these mid-latitude regions, so maybe we're seeing this mid-latitude drying. The other thing that we notice here is the sort of very blobby nature of what's happening here, and especially the red blobs. Of course, the big signals Isabella talked about, and some of our other speakers talked about. So Isabella talked about Greenland and Antarctica, and you know, some of the biggest signals are the ice sheets and the glaciers, Alaska, Patagonia, and somewhat around the Tibetan Plateau as well. But really, after that, the next big signals are from the aquifers. And we're seeing these red spots, which correspond to groundwater depletion, all over the world. We're starting to visit many of these. So China, southeastern Russia, India. Isabella and I are co-authors on a paper on that. Down here in Australia, we're pretty sure this is related to mining, to the water that's used for mining. The Middle East, of course, a heavy groundwater user, the Guarani Aquifer System. There's a lot of work that's going on, even in our department, like with Jim Renderson, for example, starting to look at Amazon drought. And they think that it's in part related to some changes in sea surface temperatures, but also in part related to deforestation, so the droughts that are showing up there. And of course, in the United States, southeastern US, High Plains Aquifer in the Central Valley, which we recently wrote a paper on. Sometimes very difficult to separate out a signal that's interannual variability, driven by interannual variability, for example, due to El Nino, and a human signal due to groundwater overuse. Because when there's a drought, by definition, there's not as much rain, and we tend to use more groundwater. Okay, so some of these signals are actually mixed climate, interannual variability, and human signals. So the point is, you know, like some of our speakers said this morning, you know, some of the uncertainties may be large, but there's a stable picture that is emerging. And over time, the error bars will shrink. And so it's time for us to to move forward with more comprehensive water management, and also to think about the security implications like Richard Matthew will talk about. Richard is just coming back from an NRC panel on Himalayas and security issues related to glacial and snow melt. And this is one that Connie, I think, mentioned this morning. So I think he's going to focus on that. And so I put together some slides that kind of zoom in on this Tibetan Plateau region. And so here it is. It's just taking the trend map. We've changed the scale up a little bit relative to the last slide. But you can see increasing snow storage. But, you know, around the plateau, you've got glaciers melting. You've got glaciers recharging groundwater aquifers. And of course, you know, billions of people, a couple of billion people live over there and are, you know, using the water for irrigated agriculture. So it's being depleted at a quite a rapid clip. So here's what, if we just look at some of the storage variations by river basin, this is what they look like. Again, the ups and downs, storage curve would go up when during the rainy season here, for example, in the Ganga, and then decrease, say, during the dry season when there's a lot of evaporation. So you can start to see a lot of these ups and downs, and you can see that there's decreasing trends in some of these basins. Anyway, you can see in a lot of these major aquifers that there's quite a significant downward trend in groundwater availability. These are places where lots of people live. There's a lot of poverty. Some of them are transboundary, for example, the India-Pakistan in northwestern India. And so there's big issues that that Richard Matthew will talk about. And then it's not just a problem that is limited to the Tibetan Plateau, but it's a map of all of the world's major aquifer systems and groundwater depletion in a lot of the ones that showed up as red on that trend map. So I looked at the map and, you know, picked out the blobs that were decreasing, showed a decreasing trend, and then plotted these time series. And so you can see that this groundwater depletion is really a global phenomenon. So we're not really just limiting what we're this problem is not just limited to South Asia. There's been several papers that say, okay, well, now you can tell us what the contribution of groundwater is to sea level rise because you have all this GRACE data. And the truth is that we can't, because we don't know how much of that water ends up back in an aquifer or evaporates or, you know, whatever, leaves the region as virtual water in food. And so it's a mistake to say that we're just going to take the water from an aquifer and it's going to end up in the ocean. I would make the same case for the Himalayan glaciers, for example. So glaciers that discharge to the ocean, like in Alaska or something, sure, that's water that's ice that's going to end up straight in the ocean. This is a project that Isabel and I have been working on for some time now, and this is using the GRACE data to look at basically the weight of all the water in the world, but we've broken it up by land and ice sheets and oceans, okay? And so each line shows how the mass changes, the mass of the land changes, or the mass of the ocean changes, or the mass of the ice sheets changes. And most of these changes, again, are due to water storage because we've corrected for the things that are not water. And so there's a couple of important things that you can see. And one is that, you know, there's these ups and downs. So we get the ups when there's precipitation, and down when there's evaporation and stream flow into the ocean. And of course, that stream flow into the ocean then is an input for the ocean, right? So it goes up when there's precipitation or when there's increasing stream flow, and then it goes down when there's evaporation. So they're out of phase, and that out of phase representation really represents the working of the water cycle. And here's the ice sheets. And so these data are you know, pretty much consistent with Isabella's data. Some of the trends over here are over here on the side, and they sort of balance out. There's a couple of messages, though. The reason I put this slide on here is because we feel that after watching these data for some time, that the amplitude of this storage curve, the ups and the downs, is getting bigger over time. And that means more variability. Okay, that means more precipitation and more evaporation, more, you know, water physically up into the atmosphere and more water down. Okay, that sort of variability makes water management extremely difficult. It implies more flooding. It implies more drought. It implies more vulnerability, which Richard will talk about. So we've actually started to try to quantify this, and this is some stuff that JT Rager is working on, and so we're just kind of plotting the amplitude because we think that the amplitude of those storage curves is basically a metric for the strength of the water cycle. The more up and down you have, the stronger the water cycle, the more precipitation and evaporation. And so this is just a plot of how the amplitude of the storage curves change. You know, it's like charting the ups and downs of your weight. If you weighed yourself once a month over many, many years, you know, you'd see ups and downs, at least I do. And, you know, the more ups and downs you have in your weight, you know, the tougher it is to control your weight and manage your weight. The more ups and downs you have with, you know, the water cycle, water storage, the tougher it is to manage. So this overall trend, say we're looking at land, it just shows that the amplitude is getting bigger from 2003 to about 2007, decreasing a little bit, but certainly there's an overall increase. And one thing that's terribly clear is that when we think about glacial, interglacial time periods, that certainly the water cycle has been, the amplitude, the strength of the water cycle has been increasing on those timescales for sure. So this shouldn't be new information for us, but it is in part because we've never had this kind of information before. We've never had this giant scale in the sky with which we could weigh water changes. And now we're going to pass it on to Professor Matthew, who will talk about implications or whatever he wants to talk about. It's coming up next. Thank you.